To WA now, where the proposed gas hub in the Kimberley region continues to divide the local community. In part two of Allan Clarke's report on this explosive issue, he analyses the politics behind this multi-billion dollar project.
Toxic coconut. These two words ignited the most recent explosive chapter in the fight for James Price Point on the Kimberley coast of Western Australia. Printed in an anonymous newsletter aimed at those in favour of a proposed multi-billion dollar liquid natural gas processing hub. It means black on the outside and white on the inside. A highly offensive term, it was hurled directly at Western Australian Aboriginal MP, Carol Martin.
I've not been black all my life, mate, okay? Really simple. It is the worst racial vilification I've actually seen, okay? Now, as far as I'm concerned, it's also cowardly. What sort of bastardry is that? Now, why would you do that to another person?
Unfazed by the insult, Carol doesn't pull any punches about the issue, and her support for the gas hub is steadfast. She says those opposed are being selfish and will hinder economic independence for Indigenous people in the Kimberley.
There are people that are interested in working, getting away from drugs, getting away from sitting around getting themselves in strife, you know. There are a lot of young people that want an opportunity. So we have to, look, people like me, yoo-hoo, my job. It's my job. My job is to make sure that there is a future for our kids. Am I the only one that sees this? And there's a $1.4 billion social justice package. Does anybody realise this? This is about business. This is about economic participation. This is about scholarships. This is about anything we can do to actually help our community and our kids in the future.
While the project comes with a $1.5 billion incentive and employment package for the local Aboriginal community, Gullarabaloo traditional owner Philip Rowe says no amount of money could ever replace the cultural significance of Wamadan, the traditional name of James Price Point.
To a white man's eye, it's nothing. But in the black fella side of things, it means a hell of a lot. It's a school. This is our university, you know? It's a uni for us. That's why the Luan culture, still today, is very powerful in the Kimberley.
Philip has been at the forefront of protests to save James Price Point. Keeping vigil at the makeshift Wamadan embassy for the past year, he says he'll fight until the end, saying his ancestors would be turning in their graves.
It makes you sick, you know? But I'll leave that down the track because my main aim here is to stand and stand strong in for what I believe, you know, in ourselves.
Philip says it's far from a war of words. It's become a war of action. Back in July, a month into a blockade by protesters to the LNG construction site, tensions came to a head. Riot squads went toe-to-toe with environmentalists, activists, and traditional owners. Dozens of arrests were made, but those opposed still stand strong. Today, Woodside Petroleum workers are forced to wait every morning for police to clear the access road to the construction site.
We do have issues with some of our staff getting abused. Some of our staff have been sworn at. Some of our staff have been assaulted. Some of our staff have been spat on.
Woodside's Aboriginal Employment Officer in Broome, Lindsay Gredilex, believes that those stirring the pot are outsiders.
I've been a police officer for 22 years. I'm used to people calling me all sorts of names. I remain professional in my role. And my people, the Jabba Jabba people, have been very strong. And we've kept within ourselves and we haven't lashed out at people. And I'm very proud of my people for doing that.
Yeah, you know, my mother said everywhere you went, you left that place better than how you found it. Yeah, that's right. What we want to do.
Traditional owner Ampelina was recently elected to the local council on an anti-gas hub ticket. She says beneath the pressure cooker is a group of concerned traditional owners with reasonable demands.
We're being bullied by the state government. We're being bullied by the Premier, who's saying that this development that's coming to Price's Point to Womadon is going to happen, and that people in local government have very little say because they have limited powers, the legislation is limited. And as I said, I think that we, people in the Kimberley, are just tired of that. We want an opportunity to sit down with the Premier of this state. One of the things that I've been pushing is the alternatives. I do not believe that the governments have seriously considered the alternatives to piping the gas, either to the Pilbara or processing offshore.
Wayne Bergman, former head of the Kimberley Land Council, had the task of negotiating between traditional owners and Woodside Petroleum. He looks back on those days and says that the threat of compulsory acquisition of James Price Point by WA Premier Colin Barnett has led to a volatile environment.
Sometimes sacrificing things for the greater good of all to try and create opportunities to improve on where government has left us behind, have not delivered the level of services it should. I never thought that we would have had such an obvious disagreement amongst ourselves, and even by people who have been great supporters of this project. I don't think we could have ever contemplated that.
Away from the war raging in headlines, boardrooms, parliament and the blockade site over the future of James Price Point, traditional owner Neil McKenzie stands in a peaceful gully, bookended by Pindan Cliffs.
The impact of development happening here in this wilderness and precious and significant country will be enormous impact. It'll be devastating. It'll be complete desecration of our cultural and heritage sites and significant areas.
With final approval for the LNG hub yet to happen, both sides show no sign in backing down.
Allan Clarke reporting there. And remember, if you'd like to have your say on this story or any other stories in today's program, just go to our website. Still to come on this special edition of Living Black from the Big Apple, Torres Strait Island families reconnect with long-lost relatives from New Caledonia.